functional classification of oral mucosa. If you look at the functional classification based on the function, they classified as masticatory mucosa constituting 25%, lining mucosa or reflecting mucosa constituting 60%, and specialized mucosa constituting 15%. So masticatory mucosa, you have gingiva and the hard palate. Lining mucosa is 60%, that is lips, the labial buccal mucosa, vestibular fornix, alveolar mucosa, floor of the mouth, and the soft palate. Specialized mucosa is basically the dorsum of the tongue and the taste buds. Now, there are some differences between lining and masticatory mucosa. But what are the differences? Lining mucosa is soft and pliable, and hence administration of local anesthesia. When you're extracting the tooth, you need to give local anesthesia in the oral cavity. So it becomes very easy for you to administer the local anesthesia. And when you surgically do an excision, it gaps because it is very pliable and soft. So sutures are required. Whereas in case of masticatory mucosa, it is firm and immobile. Therefore, local anesthesia administration is difficult. Not only difficult, but it is also painful. And then surgically excised suture is not required. Well, we're going to go into detail of each of these mucosa. And whenever you study of any mucous membrane, remember these four things. You should know the type of covering epithelium, the degree of keratinization, and the thickness of epithelium. The structure of the lamina propria, density and thickness, and the presence or lack of elasticity, the form or function between the epithelium and lamina propria, and the membrane fixation to the underlying structure, that is the submucosa. So coming to the first, that is your masticatory mucosa, basically mainly keratinized. You also have, that is gingiva and the hard palate, but there are some non-keratinized areas in the gingiva, that is sulcular epithelium, junctional epithelium, and the interdental coat. Hard palate has basically morphologically macroscopic appearance. You have the incisive papilla, you have the palatal rugae, and you have the mid-palatine raphe. So mucous membrane over here is tightly fixed to the underlying periosteum, hence immovable, pink in color. The epithelium is uniform, it is well keratinized surface, and the lamina propria is thicker in the anterior than the posterior parts and consists of bands of dense fibrous connective tissue. Well, the submucosa is dense collagenous, and based on that, it's classified into four regions on the nature of the submucosa, that is your gingival region, just adjacent to the tooth, the palatal raphe region, which is there in the center, and the anterior lateral area or the fatty zone, and the posterior lateral area or the glandular zone. And the posterior part of the hard palate, the junction of the alveolar processes and horizontal plate of the hard palate, cover the anterior palatine vessels and nerves, which is surrounded by a loose connective tissue. So, anterolateral part of the zone we have seen on the microscope also in most of the colleges. We saw the slide where the retro ridges are numerous, they are broad, they are long, they are regular retro ridges, the lamina propria, and in the submucosa you see adipose tissue or the fat cells. Whereas in case of the posterior lateral zone in the submucosa, we see the salivary gland tissue, that is the minor salivary glands are seen in this area. The incisive papilla, it is formed by dense connective tissue. It contains oral part of vestigial mesopalatine duct lined by simple columnar epithelium, and together with the Jacobs's organ is considered as auxiliary olfactory sense organ. Whereas the palatine rugae is very important as far as the identification of an individual concerned. There are different types of palatine rugae pattern which can be seen, and the study of this palatine rugae is called as rugoscopy. It extends laterally from the incisive papillae and any part of the tongue and is made up of dense connective tissue. Well, we all know that once the tooth develops, the epithelial remnants are found entrapped in the lamina propria as well as the maxillary bone proper, and sometimes they may be arranged concentrically in layers as epithelial cells depending on the keratinization. Then you have the raphe zone. The raphe zone are basically highly keratinized. They have pegs, a long and slender, you have the lamina propria, which consists of dense fibrous connective tissue. Well, coming to the next, that is your gingiva. Now, gingiva is a part of the oral mucosa that covers the alveolar processes of the jaws and surrounds the necks of the teeth. So, you have the marginal gingiva, which is exactly surrounding the tooth. You have interdental gingiva, which is present in between the tooth. And you have the attached gingiva, which is attached to the alveolar bone. So, and you have the mucogingival free gingival glue, which separates the marginal gingiva from the free gingiva. So, this is how you can see the whole of the structure, and the gingiva is separated from the alveolar mucosa by the mucogingival junction. So, marginal gingiva, it's used approximately 1 mm wide, is divided from the entire gingiva by free gingival groove, forms a soft tissue wall of the gingival sulcus and can be easily separated by a periodontal probe. It surrounds the tooth like a collar fashion. The attached gingiva is continuous to that of the marginal gingiva. This is very firm, it is resilient, it is tightly bound to the underlying spongiosteum. It gives you the beauty orange appearance because of the stippling which is present on it. It gives you the beauty orange appearance. And the facial aspect extends to the oral mucosa demarcated by the mucogingival junction. And this attached gingiva is thickest in the maxilla in the anterior region, and it is thinnest in the first premolar, both in the maxilla and the mandible. Another thing that you find is the interdental gingiva. This is present in between the two teeth, in the gingival embrasures, and beneath the contact of the tooth. They're basically pyramidal in shape, and or they may be 10-shaped in the posterior area. Now there is something which is called as comb. They are valley-like depressions connecting the facial and the lingual part of the epithelium. So interdental papilla in three-dimension view of the posterior teeth is 10-shaped, and this particular core which is present is like a valley, and it is non-keratinized epithelium and is most vulnerable to the periodontal diseases. Now microscopically, you have the outer epithelium, you have the sulcular epithelium, and you have the junctional epithelium. So masticatory mucosa, basically it is 75% is parakeratinized, 15% is autokeratinized, and 10% is non-keratinized. The basins rest on well-defined basin membrane. They are polygonal cells, mitotic activity, basal cells are extremely high. So you can see that histologically, you see long, numerous, slender sweaty ridges which are having a forking pattern. Because they're part of the masticatory mucosa, the long gutty ridges increases the area for withstanding the masticatory forces. And therefore, we can see these numerous long gutty ridges, and the lamina propria is dense, consisting of the collagen fibers, and submucosa is absent. So, keratinized stratified squamous epithelium, which is parakeratinized 75%, orthokeratinized 15%, and 10% it is non-keratinized. The principal cells are keratinocytes, other cells are Langerhans cells, Merkel cells which are non-keratinocytes, and also the melanocytes. The sulcular epithelium is non-keratinized, non-epithelial cells are seen. Normal probing depth is 2 to 3 mm, histologic depth is 1 to 8 mm. And then you have something which is called as the junctional epithelium, which is non-keratinized and consists of basal and suprabasal cells which is present in this area. The connective tissue, the papillary area, consists of projections into epithelial reticles and reticular layer which is in contact with the periosteum of the alveolar tube. Now, what are the components which are there? Other apart from this, you have the fibroblasts, you have the fibers, that is oxidized fibers, reticulin fibers, you have the elastic fibers and ground substances. Apart from that, you have vessels and nerves which are present innervating it. Also, there are a group of gingival fibers which are present here, which contain basically type 1 collagen, that is circular fibers, dentogingival fibers, dentoperiosteal fibers, and the transseptal group of fibers which run from one to the other above the cementum. So you should know the blood supply of gingiva and the heart palate. You should know the nerve supply of gingiva and the heart palate, and also it's very important. Coming to the lining mucosa. Now when we talk about the lining mucosa is covering the soft palate, ventral surface of the tongue, the floor of the mouth, and the alveolar mucosa. All of them are basically non-keratinized. And except for the alveolar mucosa, the soft palate, ventral surface of tongue, and the floor of the mouth, ventral surface of the tongue, these two structures show the presence of taste buds. Now, soft palate, we know there are minor salivary glands which are present in that. There are elastic fibers are reduced in number in the soft palate. Whereas in the ventral surface of the tongue, the tissue is very pliable. There are short papillae, elastic fibers. Few salivary gland tissue is present, and in the floor of the mouth, there is basement membrane is thin, short papillae are present, and the submucosa consists of the loose fibrous connective tissue and minor salivary glands. So all of them do have the minor salivary glands which are present. Coming to the lip and the cheek, this is very, very important, the lip and the cheek. You have the labial and the ductal mucosa, which are again non-keratinized stratified squamous lining. They are often parakeratinized in the occlusal plane, that is because of friction which is happening in that area. The lamina propria is short, irregular papilla, dense fibrous connective tissue containing collagen and some elastic fibers which are rich vascular supply. And submucosa consists of dense collagen tissue with minor salivary glands and firmly attached to the underlying muscle. Now, we all know that lip formula. It is only found in the human beings. It is a transitional zone between the skin of the lip and the mucous membrane, and it is red in color, hence the terminology as formula. Why it is red in color? Because there is increased vascularity. There are a lot of blood vessels in that area, and therefore it appears red in color. Apart from this, we know that there are different frenums which are present. You have the labial frenum, you have buccal frenum, you have lingual frenum. All these are nothing but these are bands of connective tissue which are holding the structure to the labial mucosa is held on by these labial frenum onto the alveolar mucosa. Specialized mucosa, we know this is the tongue and the taste buds. So we all know the structure of tongue. How is the structure of tongue? This is basically the structure of tongue. And if you see the histological structure of tongue, it has basically having stratified squamous, keratinized epithelium. You have lot of lingual papillae bearing taste buds. You have lamina propria, which is consisting of long papillae, mucus, and serous glands can be seen here. There is no distinct layer of the submucosa, but mucosa is bound to the surrounding the submucosal musculature of the tongue. Now, these are different papillae that we find on the tongue. Filiform papillae, they're filiform, red-like, very fine, pointed, do not contain the taste buds. Okay? Curving epithelium is keratinized, forms tuft at the apex of the dermal papillae. Fungiform, they're called fungiform because they are mushroom-like. And epithelium is thus capillary in this area as heavy capillary network can be seen. So they're reddish in color, they contain 1 to 3 taste buds. You have the valine papillae, the valine papillae, the circumvallate papillae, where you have the presence of the serous, purely serous salivary glands, and the waldeyer glands, contains the taste buds. You have the foliate papillae, they are narrow fold of mucous membrane, and they also contain the taste buds. So what are taste buds? Taste buds are small, ovoid or barrel-shaped intraepithelial organs about 80 micrometer high and 40 micrometer thick. They extend from the basal lamina to the surface of the epithelium, as you can see in this picture. They're consisting of the taste pore, which is covered by few epithelial cells surrounding a small opening, which is called as a taste pore. And it has the outer supporting cells, which are called as the sustentacular cells, which are stalks of barrel, while inner and spindle-shaped cells are there. Then you have the sensory cells, which are basically the receptor cells, the neuroreceptor cells, which are 10 to 12 with a dark staining nucleus which is present. Now, where is the location of these taste buds? They are located on the different papillae which are present. And you can see that they are basically basal cells or stem cells which give rise to new taste cells with a turnover rate of 10 days. So, they are neuroepithelial cells. They perceive the taste sensations. They are chemically sensitive microvilli of the taste cells which respond to the chemical stimuli, and whatever we eat, these are the taste buds that gives us that wonderful taste of the food being very good. I know everybody's quarantined at home. Your moms are cooking very good food for you all, and all of you all are enjoying the different tastes like sweet, sour, bitter, and salty. These are the 4 different taste sensations that we have. So they are actually located at different locations. Like taste buds, for fungiform is at the fungiform papillae at the tip of the tongue for sweet. The sour taste buds in the foliate papillae on the palate and posterior part of the tongue. The bitter ones are on the middle part of the tongue, where we have the circumvallate papillae, and the salty ones are on the lateral border of the tongue. And these are innervated. The bitter and sour are mediated by the glossopharyngeal nerve. The sweet and salty taste sensations are mediated by intermediofacial nerve by the caudal tympani. You also have the Waldeyer's ring, which is present in the base of the tongue. You should remember that there are 2 palatine tonsils, 2 lingual tonsils, and 2 tibial tonsils, which are present in the base of the tongue. Now, there is something which is called as a gingival sulcus, where you have the attachment of the tooth with the soft tissue, which extends from the pre-gingival margin to the dentogingival junction. It is non-keratinized and is a very important structure. Now, there are 3 junctions which are present in the oral mucosa, that is a mucocutaneous junction, where the skin lip is meeting with that of the labial mucosa, the vermilion border, that is your mucocutaneous junction. Then you have the mucogingival junction, where the gingiva is meeting with that of the alveolar mucosa. And the 3rd one is the dentogingival junction, which is between the gingiva, the soft tissue, and the tooth, which is the hard tissue. So what is the dentogingival junction? It is a junction between the gingiva and the tooth, It is of great physiological and clinical importance. It has two structures, the epithelial attachment and the attachment epithelium. Now, how does this develop? It basically develops when there is a fusion of the oral epithelium and the enamel epithelium. And when the ridges enamel epithelium, oral epithelium meet and fuse, they form the primary epithelial attachment epithelium. And this primary attachment epithelium, which is present, there is a shift of this dentogingival junction. The first stage is where at the bottom of the gingival sulcus is at the enamel covered crown, and the apical end of the attachment is at the cemento enamel junction in tessellated state till 1 year, and before shedding, this is how the attachment is present. In the second stage, the end of attachment epithelium is moved to the surface of the cementum, as you can see in the picture. In the third stage, the attachment epithelium, which is there, the gingival sulcus is at the cemento enamel junction, and the clinical crown, the anatomical crown, is completely exposed in this case. And in the fourth stage, it is that junctional epithelium or the sulcus is both on the cementum. And the first two stages are said to be physiological, and last two are said to be pathologic stages. So you should know the blood supply of the oral mucous membrane. You should know the nerve supply of the mucous membrane. There are some changes which occur, that is thickening of the epithelium and decrease in salivary secretion, which makes it very smooth. There may be atrophy of the papilla, usually in nutritional deficiencies, and there may be some lingual varices which may form. Also, we know there may be atrophy of the salivary gland, there is loss of perception, loss of taste sensation,